It's been an hour.
It's under S. Under S.
I did a commercial for American Express where I'm complaining about what I shot on a kid's birthday party. That's what I do.
Oh.
God, you take myself too. The word is seriously, I guess. But you know what? The damn thing is, you gotta be serious about making a picture.
Don't shake it like that, I'm telling you.
Pete it from the beginning.
I had trouble reading. My parents didn't have books in the house. They were, you know, garment district workers. They didn't have books.
It was more of a visual tradition, I was taken to movie theaters a lot. Also, being a sickly child with very severe asthma, I couldn't play sports. So again, the movie theater and the church and the movie theater.
Amen. Church wants you in your place. Kneel, stand.
Okay, thanks a lot, Lord. Thanks a lot for opening my eyes.
Man makes his own way. No one gives it to you. Have to take it.
This particular priest did help try to balance common sense in the world and also moral sense. But the world we're in, you know, there was the Bowery, when they called them the bums at the time, living on the Bowery, were part of the world that I grew up in. There was a criminal element, along with the working class people who were just trying to stay alive, and the older Sicilians and Neapolitans who had come to America who didn't speak English. So much was entangled when went on in that neighborhood and in my own life. And it was so powerful to me. The desire to tell these stories on film came from that.
I was sort of split between still thinking of the priesthood and becoming fascinated, totally obsessed with film. And I was beginning to see other foreign films. I was just consumed by this extraordinary input of other cultures, you know, and I was just enriching everything. And then I'm going to forget seeing Bergman during the time I was in high school, seeing The Seventh Seal.
Du fick svart.
Det passar ju bäst så. Intressant.
My memories and my emotional makeup, which had to do more with my family and my father and his family as his brothers, was eventually to find its way into Mean Streets, and also about myself and my old friends.
Hey, officer, can I get my hat? No. Can I call my wife?
No. It was the old story, as in Mean Streets or a number of the other films. You're in the front lines of a world that is pretty tough and pretty negative, and at times evil is all around you. How do you try to live balanced, not balanced, but how do you try to live a moral life?
What should I do?
Don't do anything. This business is bad.
Can I help?
Yeah, you can help by waiting.
I'm going to help him if I don't. What's the matter? Nobody tries anymore.
Tries what?
Just tries to help, that's all, help people.
You help yourself first.
Bullshit, Therese, that's where you're all wrong.
And the moment I went into a preparatory seminary, I was only 15 or so, I was determined. This was one way of getting out, and this was going to be also to separate myself and not having to deal with the moral issues of the streets and what I was involved in.
Shut the door.
I mean, there are a lot of people working on the Bowery. I saw people taking care of all the poor guys in the Bowery. You know, you walk right by them, they're dying, thrown up in the street right there. You know, and I saw the missionaries come, or some just from social workers working in the street with them. But we saw the soup kitchen, those guys would be going in, they'd be fed. You know,
And that interests me. That makes a person so selfless that can do that. Just have that compassion.
Christ did not die for the good and beautiful. That is easy enough. The hard thing is to die for the miserable and corrupt.
That's what led to also Kundun. The idea of a man or a woman who deals in a life of spirituality. And so it always interested me of people who live in the world. Jesus lived in the world. He wasn't in a temple. He wasn't in a church. He was in the world. He was on the street.
How is human life precious?
Who are you?
Do you recognize me?
Who are you?
If you're not part of Renaissance Italy, if you're not part of a world in which you can go off into the desert, let's say, and be a monk and a hermit and all that, but you've got to deal every way with people, and the world you're dealing with them in is a rough world, it's a primitive world, it's a savage world. Can you still be a good person?
I just come out of confession, right? And the priest gives me the usual penance, right? 10 Hail Marys, 10 Our Fathers, 10 whatever. You know that next week I'm going to come back and he's going to just give me another 10 Hail Marys and another 10 Our Fathers, and I mean, you know how I feel about that shit.
What have you got to confess to that anointed pederast? A confessional seal these days, I'm not so sure.
Those things, they don't mean anything to me. They're just words. Now, that may be okay for the others, but it just doesn't work for me. I mean, if I do something wrong, I just want to pay for it my way. So I do my own penance for my own sins.
The thing about it is, like, you know, it's the thing of faith versus a kind of a spiritual change that you have to do in yourself. Whether there's a God or is no God, you still got to do it. And if you could say, like the beginning of Mean Streets, you know, you make up for your sins at home and in the streets, not in church. You don't, if you transgress, the transgression that you have to undo is with the person, is with the people. It's not going to church on Sunday. And very often people think, I go to church on Sunday, I'm okay, and yes, Jesus was this way, and yes, he suffered this way, and all that sort of thing. But what was the suffering for?
You excuse yourself! That is the spirit of darkness!
And what would you do for them? Pray? And get what in return? Only more suffering. A suffering only you can end. Not God!
Away from me!
I pray too, Rodriguez. It doesn't help.
Well, kids say, well, if God is God and he dies on the cross, he's God, he knows he's going to live, so why is he suffering? He doesn't have anything to suffer, he doesn't understand us. Well, that's not the case. This one suffers from the very beginning and fights against it.
Father, I'm sorry for being a bad son.
What'll it be then? Rib or chop?
Father, stay with me. Don't leave me.
Ultimately, it has to do with, and I would have to be careful with this sort of thing, but it has to do with the emphasis on Christianity in my mind. My experience has been maybe the dark side of it. And yet I know there's supposed to be a light. There's supposed to be a redemption. There's supposed to be something that that is uplifting, something that takes you out of yourself, and that I guess one would call a redemption. I don't know if I'm there. And that's what that Father Principe said when he saw a taxi driver. He said, well, I'm glad you ended it on Easter Sunday, not on Good Friday. And then ultimately told me there's too much Good Friday, not enough Easter Sunday in your films.
All the animals come out at night. Whores, skunk pussies, buggers, queens, fairies, dopers, junkies. Sick, venal. Someday a real rain will come and wash all the scum off the streets.
He is the avenging angel. He's the one who's going to clean up everybody. He's going to set the world straight.
The idea had been growing in my brain for some time. True force. All the king's men cannot put it back together again.
We understood how he felt. And, I mean, disaffected, disillusioned, maybe ostracized from mainstream society. Maybe for me, in my own personal life, being an outsider. He's an outsider, a loner, a loser to a certain extent. And there was something that touched a chord.
Loneliness has followed me my whole life, everywhere. Bars and cars, sidewalks, stores, everywhere. There's no escape. And God's a lonely man.
The fantasy is as real as the reality.
Listen, I don't want to be cruel, but really, we're in front of Jerry's building. God forbid he should see me with you, because Jerry and I have a real relationship going. You know what I mean? No fantasy world. You know what I'm talking about?
It's real. Dreams are real.
The clock's ticking, my friend. We're running out of time.
The paranoia is real. The people may not be doing anything against you, but you believe they are.
I got some bad ideas in my head.
A man like this, under the circumstances, crossing over the fantasy line and acting out. I think he's going to do it again.
Hey!
It just seemed to me, no matter what the character is, that you're going along the journey with that character. You may like the character, you may not, but it's just that you're interested in the character.
Please give your warmest welcome to the newest king of comedy, Rupert Pupkin!
Taxi driver, Travis, Rupert, the isolated person. Is Rupert more violent than Travis? Maybe. Therefore, for me, the whole movie, every scene, had levels of hostility as to how he was expressing this hostility.
Thank you very much. When Jerry finds a moment, good. Thank you. When will that be?
Particularly, the key scene for me is Shelley Hack and De Niro, where she comes out and tells him about his tape. And he has one line, which I thought was always very important. Excuse me, but are you speaking for Jerry?
May I ask you a question?
Yes.
Are you speaking for Jerry?
Yes, I am.
Because that's a pretty hostile line. That means, like, who the hell are you? You don't know what goes on between Jerry and me. You're just a lackey.
I don't have faith in your judgment.
Well, I'm sorry that you feel that way.
But it's a very moving thing, particularly when the security guard comes to take him out.
Please. I'm waiting for Jerry. It's personal.
We'll talk about that outside. Please, sir, take
him. I know he's expecting me.
Is very moving because he tries to be nice, but he's really hostile. He's really he's really got bad intentions.
Well, I find that strange, you know. But it's typical. Because that's the way they treat even you. Because I'll let you in on a little secret. That's the way they treated me.
Because you want to let all those kids in high school who didn't like you and those teachers who didn't like you know that you are really a great person and they were wrong.
None of us dreamt that he would amount to a hill of beans. But we were wrong. And you, Rupert, you were right.
You have a value that they didn't see, that you know you had. It's like some childish fantasy.
We'd like to apologize to you personally.
But I think that's the poignancy, the living out of the fantasies and Rupert wanting to be justified in the face of his high school principal.
And to beg your forgiveness for all the things we did to you.
Slaps both hands on the head. Hurts Robinson again. Hooks the left hand of the jaw right to the body. Robinson goes back with a right on the nose. Lamont drives him across the ring. A left and a right to the head. A hard left hand of the body. And Robinson is driven out of the ring.
When I did Mean Streets, and that was generated by me, and I felt a passion to make that. When I did Alice Doesn't Live Anymore, that was like a studio assignment work, but we're able to work with a wonderful actress like Ellen Burstyn, and to explore other ideas, to explore different kinds of thinking.
Yeah, I know, but it's my life. Yeah, my life. It's not some man's life that I'm going to help him out with.
No wonderful way. And enjoyable experience. And Taxi Driver, De Niro and myself, we all felt as powerfully attached to it as Schrader did. New York, New York came from something that I wanted to do and explore genre, and I started to fool around mixing genre, and that was a failure at the box office and in Hollywood. And it sort of set me off on a road feeling I never knew if I'd have the passion again to do something for myself. I found that ultimately when I was in the hospital, it was kind of like a kind of a strange miracle in a way. I couldn't reach any further down. I was on bottom.
It's over for me. Boxing's over for me. I'm true. I'm tired of worrying about weight all the time. That's all I used to think about was weight, weight, weight.
What are you worried about? What's the biggest thing you got to worry about?
You're worried about the weight.
You worried about the weight?
What are we arguing about for? I just said the weight.
Once I understood that the boxing ring was also the kitchen and the bedroom.
Why'd you do it?
That's what I understood the picture. I said, that's the house, and that's your relationship with people. And then the feeling that the guilt for whatever reasons he had in his life and feeling that he doesn't even deserve to live.
I've done a lot of bad things, Joey. Maybe it's coming back to me.
The film had a rage in it that I saw in my grandparents and this anger that he has, that he acts out on everybody else.
Oh, my God.
I mean, I can't articulate what he is or who he is, but I know that we did it as honestly as possible. And if it's the aspects of ourselves in there, yes. People look down sometimes, they say, oh, people like that, it's terrible. They just go rob apartments. But sometimes people, it's the old story. They're forced by circumstances, environment. Genes, I don't know what it is, but they live a certain, they're forced to live a certain way. It doesn't mean that they wouldn't live another way if somebody came in or something happened in their lives that would have changed.
You were kind of a double kid, I bet, right? Huh? One kid with your old man, one kid with your mother, you're upper middle class during the weeks, then you're dropping your eyes and you're hanging in the big bad salty projects with your daddy the fucking donkey on the weekends. I got that right?
Judging other people and saying, that person is a bad person. They did this, they did this, they did this. How do we know if we're not in that person's place, we wouldn't do the same? Because I had a lot of people say about me over the years, and it's fine. The reality is, it's what I did. I can't run away from it. It's who I am. That's all. And what I am is up there on the screen. I think we're interested in people who are flawed, people like ourselves, and to see if anybody else cares about them.
You want to know what you care about?
I care about
your gloves.
I care about
your friends.
I care about
and your music.
You're damn right.
And your
because
gloves.
That's something
when you have a character that's pretty strong and is conflicted and hopefully obsessive, maybe a little paranoid, you can get into a very interesting thing.
An equal amount of blueberries in each muffin.
You know how long that's going to take?
I don't care how long it takes. Put an equal amount in each muffin.
It's trying to harness these emotions
and put into stories, narratives, and interpret them through images.
Give me a second. All right, what do you need?
Rudder and elevators.
It really has to do more with obsession and passion.
Yeah, these are fine. But have Simon and Pete get back to me on the hydraulic assemblies. We need a secondary system here. Okay.
And the passion doesn't necessarily have to be explosive, but it has to be there inside the actor, particularly if it's a passion that's held back, that's restrained. And that's very interesting.
That night, he did not take the customary comfort in his monthly shipment of books from London. The taste of the usual was like cinders in his mouth. And there were moments when he felt as if he were being buried alive under his future.
Who was speaking? And I never thought of that. Somebody's telling me a story. I don't understand.
Yeah.
Why is it a woman? I never thought of that. Well, first of all, it's written by a woman. It seemed kind of odd to have a man's voice to it.
He guessed himself to have been for months the center of countless silently observing eyes and patiently listening ears.
Why couldn't we have a taste of that? Why couldn't we have a taste of what it sounds like when you read?
It was not the custom in New York drawing rooms for a lady to get up and walk away from one gentleman in order to seek the company of another. But the Countess did not observe this rule.
What's interesting to me in Age of Innocence is the tribal aspect, that they behave a certain way, that in the upper classes, it's less you say, it's somber colors, you eat a certain way, you don't have dinner to eat and to fill yourself. It's a social obligation. Mm-hmm. And all of this, but without all that, they're still human, they have the same desires.
Does no one cry here either? I suppose there's no need to.
I reacted immediately to the passion of the love story between Archer and Ellen, and especially the fact that it's unconsummated, and especially, therefore, the tension, the dramatic conflict, the tension.
The women in the story are very much in the forefront and really control the story in a way, Madame Olenska and Mae Welland, along with the others. And there's also then taking into question the nature of Newland Archer, whether it's weakness and or ultimately a loyalty and obligation and finally responsibility to a world which created him only too well. That's his choice, ultimately.
You gave me my first glimpse of a real life. And then you told me to carry on with a false one. No one can endure that.
I'm enduring it.
It's refinement, and it's refined violence. It's emotional and psychological violence, just as powerful and just as deadly as Joe Pesci getting shot in Goodfellas. I really believe that.
I'm afraid you can't, dear. Not unless you take me with you.
And it had to do with the sense of responsibility, obligation, sacrifice. And it had to do with the emotion of it. It had to do with wanting something that we're not going to get.
Dude, why don't you answer my calls when I call? You think I don't know you're here?
Let's not have any trouble.
You think I don't know?
No matter how big I get, no matter who I fight, no matter what I do, I ain't never going to fight you loose. I ain't never gonna get a chance to fight the best there is. And you know something? I'm better than him.
Girl, I'll have a good time. You can't get crazy. See, I have to be in control. And I like being in control. But you know, for one night, I'd like to see myself out of my head. Wouldn't you like to see me out of my head? Wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't that be fabulous?
Peggy, I just want to talk.
I see a safe journey. I see a safe return.
Way of the future. The way of the future.
Not our future.
Young people today don't know about they don't get a sense of the history of the city or the history of the country in terms of the actual struggle within the country, especially in the 19th century, which turns out to be the most violent century in American history.
There is danger of mob attacking Armory, corner 21st Street, 2nd Avenue. There's about 500 stand of arms in it.
The Civil War and the riots in the streets of Boston and Philadelphia and New York. A lot of this action with the gangs was politically motivated and racist, very racist. The Irish were considered anathema to these people.
Be right there, Mr. Cutting. Americans are burning.
I don't see no Americans. I see trespassers. Irish harps will do a job for a nickel what a nigger does for a dime and a white man used to get a quarter for.
I always wondered when I was a kid, why would the church be named St. Patrick's in a neighborhood that was all Italians? And then I began to realize, of course, we weren't the first ones here. There were plenty of stories of the people who came before us, stories that seemed to come right out of the cobblestones. One of the most extraordinary had to do with the Irish who came here before us. And it happened right here at St. Patrick's. There were groups of bigots called Know-Nothings. They didn't want the Irish in America at all. This was back in 1844. They gathered together to march down Prince Street from the Bowery to burn and destroy St. Patrick's. But when they got to the corner, they saw that the place was defended, not just by Irish men, but by Irish women and by Irish children, too.
It's a touching spectacle. We'll come back when you're ready for us.
I didn't quite put together, I hadn't quite put together the issue of what it meant in terms of immigrants and America and assimilation and the right of worship, Catholic versus Protestant, separation of church and state. All of that I didn't quite get.
Which is why I'm talking about an alliance between our two great organizations.
You're talking about muscle work.
That too. Muscle to match our spirit.
You own the crushers, get them to do it.
The police? Oh no, Jesus, no.
The appearance of the law must be upheld. Especially while it's being broken.
I saw the characters were so colorful, and it was kind of a mythology of old New York in a way, like a legend.
Each of the 5 points is a finger. When I close my hand, it becomes a fist. And any time that I wish, I can turn it against you.
You see, I grew up in that area. I grew up in the area that became that was the 5 points and became Italian American area in Chinatown, and so. I sort of grew up around that church, in fact, that cathedral, St. Patrick's Old Cathedral. And there was something about that area that was just reeking with the story, you know. Not just the sanitized ones. This was stuff that really how the people lived and suffered and struggled. Immigrants coming to New York and settling there. And it was not a great place.
What is your name?
Amsterdam, sir.
I'm New York.
Start spreading the news.
That document makes you a citizen. This one makes you a private in the Union Army. Now go fight for your country.
I wanna be a part of it. New York, New York.
New York was a city full of tribes, war chiefs, rich and poor. It wasn't a city, really. It was more a furnace. We're a city someday.
New York, New York. I want to wake up in the city that doesn't sleep.
The sense of life in the city, it's something that I draw upon, the energy of it.
My little town blues.
Who you are, where you're from, whether your relatives came over on a fucking Mayflower or an inner tube from Haiti. This right here is the land of opportunity.
In old New York, if I can.
The street's not like the ER. There's no walls, no controls. To make up for that, they try to teach me how to act without thinking. Like a soldier who can take apart and reassemble a gun blindfolded.
Whatever it is, he should clean up this city here, because this city here is
like an open sewer, you know? It's full of filth and scum.
A part of who I am, where I'm from, really, is from downtown New York, downtown Manhattan. So shooting in the streets, for me, is something that's very special. And it's kind of a free experience, you know?
Come on, come through New York, New York.
You know, violence is an encompassing word. It's a word that takes in so much. It depends on the world you're depicting. It depends on the audience you're aiming for. And then there's the issue of your responsibility to the story and to the world that you're depicting. And if you're going to go on a realistic basis, let's say, where the world I came from, there was a lot of organized crime, and I saw a lot of violence where I grew up. I just saw it. It was part of it.
Give me the rest of the fucking bread.
Hey.
We're talking about the violence in my films. It's not pleasant. It's not pleasant.
Charlie M? Ah. You make me pop your fucking eye out of your head to protect that piece of shit, Charlie M, you dumb motherfucker!
It's not like a video game or like you walk in a room and spray bullets and people go flying. It doesn't work that way. It was something that was personal, serious, and had extraordinary ramifications. Things that would go on for generations and families.
Splay him out!
What's your hand, nigga?
This is fresh meat. What I mean, we need to tenderize this meat a little bit. All right, let's kiss goodnight to that pretty young face of yours.
Basically, street corner, you're going to defend your turf with another gang or against another gang, and then eventually you may combine each other into one bigger gang, give it a different name, but there's somebody who'd turn on you and there'd be a turncoat and there'd be a This goes on and on. It's just the same old cycle of violence. It just goes on and on. And it's the same kind of thing as Daniel Day-Lewis's character says, you know, I cut off a head and I put it on a man robs me, I cut off his hand. He talks against me, I cut his tongue out. And he tries to harm me, I cut his head and put it on a pike so everybody could see it. It's happening right now as we speak, all around the world.
That's what preserves the order of things. Fear.
There's also to deal with the very, very dangerous aspect of that adrenaline one has as young, that could be expressed many different ways, some sort of excitement, whether it's sexual excitement or violence or whatever. There's that danger that one has to know. That's part of what it is being human, especially young. And that could go wrong. And when it goes wrong, this could happen. Now, the world I came from, the world I knew, or aspects, I should say, of the world I knew, well, I think it was a valid form of expression. That's the world I'm, that's the human condition. That is the human condition, and it's tragic. And it's set up in such a way that it will do us in as a species if we don't learn about it. I don't put it up there for people to enjoy it, you know? And if they are enjoying it, they catch themselves enjoying it, and the characters pay for it. You reap what you sow in the stories I'm trying to tell. And I don't know any other way to show it.
Look at it, son. Live in it. Hey, you want more? Live in this content. Your mother's cut into her body, cocksucker. Live. Look at some of this shit.
Danger of the excitement. When you're young, you think you're going to live forever, and you think you're tough, and you could take a few more shots in the head than somebody else could. And so you think you're tougher than the other person. Well, eventually, if you don't use your brain, you know, you're not going to wind up anywhere. And I think the danger of the excitement of that lifestyle is what I grew up around, and I saw a lot of people disappear because of that.
From the seamless performance of this ritual, Archer knew that New York believed him to be Madame Olenska's lover.
Discussing the Martha Washington ball.
If you're part of a crew, nobody ever tells you that they're going to kill you. Doesn't happen that way.
And he understood for the first time that his wife shared the belief.
There weren't any arguments or curses like in the movies. see your murderers come with smiles. They come as your friends, the people who have cared for you all of your life, and they always seem to come at a time when you're at your weakest and most in need of their help.
Shall I see you to your carriage?
We are driving dear Ellen home.
Goodbye.
Well, I'll see you very soon in Paris.
Oh, if you and May could come.
You don't have a partner, Marshall. You came here alone.
That's when I knew I would never have come back from Florida alive.
Delightful evening.
It's pretty brutal. I think it's pretty shocking to me. That's what it was. And in some places today, it still is.
Cranberry juice.
We have to be very careful as to who insulted whom.
You really believe in that bullshit league?
Who brushed by another?
Why don't you take that fucking pen and shove it up your ass, you fucking jagoff?
Who said something a little in a nasty way?
Why don't you go fuck yourself, Tommy?
It just is the nature of the world you're in.
Hey, this is for you. Atta boy.
And it changes on a dime. It changes like that. You could be killed.
You let this fucking punk get away with that? What's the matter? What's the world coming to?
What the fucking world is coming to? How do you like that?
People always say, well, interested in the antagonist in my movies. Well, the point is that they're also human. These are also parts of the negative parts of who they are. Evil streak, so to speak, if you want to use that phrase, is also maybe something in us and something not to be afraid of, but to explore and to try to understand.
Hey, there you go. I didn't know which way you were coming from. I didn't know which way you were
coming. I think all of us under certain circumstances could be capable of some very despicable acts. Mm-hmm. I just think that. That's very dangerous because if you're teaching younger people, when they suddenly shock to find out it does exist, no, it exists. You know, I just want to get you prepared. I don't know how it's going to come at you, but it's going to be there because that's part of who we are.
Doing a job to make some extra money. For who? Now's not the time to not say.
My father was constantly in the middle of negotiating problems. There was a lot of money that wasn't paid back. There were a lot of sit-downs.
You got a beautiful family, no?
Yeah.
Maybe you should relax. Where should you get back to?
And so for 20, 25 years, that's all I heard about what's right and wrong in a situation in which, hey, you're in a jungle.
Some people say I'm not showing appreciation. Well, then fuck them.
Trying to help you, Jim.
I know you, but nobody threatens offer.
I think you can see how pressure is applied.
You know how strong I made you? And how strong?
How things are said but not said.
Tony told the old man to tell me, to tell you. Mm-hmm. It's what it is.
Yet, technically, you could say they didn't say this.
Listen to me. They wouldn't dare.
And we're looking even more closely from this vantage point in our lives at the age of 75, 76. We're looking at friendship, betrayal.
Okay.
Power.
I had to put you into this thing, or you would never let it happen.
Trust, self-preservation.
I picked us over him. Fuck him.
And then maybe the possibility of a redemption.
Pray for us sinners.
Pray for us sinners.
Now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
I was hoping that by that point in time, he's more accepting of himself. He's more gentle to himself and to the people around him. That's all. Get that far in his life would be good.
Sooner or later, everybody put here as a date when he's going to go. That's just the way it is.
It's the old line from Diary of a Country Priest. You know, God is not a torturer. He wants us to be merciful with ourselves. And that's the one. That's really where it comes out. And just take it easy on yourself.
I am sorry, God. Forgive me.
Forgive me, Rose.
It's not your fault. No one asked you to suffer. That was your idea.
It was you, Charlie.
He was my brother. You should have looked out for me a little bit.
I'm ashamed when I think of it.
Of what?
Of all the mistakes I've made.
What are you going to do, spend the rest of your life in jail? Is that what you want?
No.
Okay.
No.
Okay, you got all the money in the world. You need everybody else's money?
Take it, stupid. I'm doing it for you. Come on.
You should have looked out for me just a little bit. You should have taken care of me just a little bit.
We're going to save your life, we're going to save his life, and we're going to keep you out of jail.
Little girl, the one you dream of. The one who tells you over and over that you should have saved her. Save them all.
You should understand. It is my only chance.
You don't understand. I could have had class. I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody. Instead of a bum, which is what I am. Let's face it. It was you, Charlie. It was you, Charlie.
Howard? Howard, are you there?
What kind of a man makes a phone call like that?
It's mainly because my life may be ending. Also, there are people around me that are very close to me, and I'm finding that they plus this story seem to clarify for me what life is. And it's like a gift in a way. Can I live up to it? I don't know. Honestly, don't think so. But what you do is you keep trying. You just keep trying.